Welcome back to GDPG, where we play games so you don't have to. That's not true. You should buy this game because it's amazing.
You should put this game. Banner Saga 2, the preview.
The preview. Specifically because we're playing it before its official release. So, really the only differences are probably going to be minor defects, if anything. So, you may not even see that. There's a little skull above the rest.
So I don't know why it showed up, but a little tutorial, like, I clicked on this, and it was like, normal morale means no change is gonna happen to your willpower, and I was like, oh, that's really cool, I don't know why you just told me that, and then it was like, red skull above rest means somebody's injured. I was like, oh, I don't know why you told me that either, but now I know.
Okay.
So, yeah, so that little red skull means we should rest.
That's kind of nice. Well, it doesn't mean
injured.
We should,
no,
it just
it means
that
injured.
There's a benefit to resting.
There's also a benefit to talking to Odd.
Oddleaf.
Oddleaf, your former chieftain's widow is demonstrating fletching an arrow to a few people as you approach.
Appropriate. Give us a moment, will you?
The group walks away as Oddleaf stands and wipes loose feathers from her tunic.
I doubt you're here to explain anything with the dredge.
Your actions with the dredge.
Your actions with the dredge. I'm not very good at reading. Sorry.
Do I need to? It was nothing. I just miss a lot. I was always nice to Odd.
I mean, yeah, I was always nice to her, too. Are we comfortable enough to open up to her, though, about this?
Depends on the playthrough that you had before.
I mean, we have no one else that we're, like, that's really sympathetic with us. On, I feel like she owes us one for us being sympathetic to her when her husband died.
So now she's got a... Okay, cool.
That's not that she really owes us one, but, like...
You know, friends.
We helped her. Maybe she'll help us, like, cope with our loss. That's really what I'm getting at. I can only imagine.
She watches you in silent, not pressing you to continue. Eventually, she changes the subject.
I want to discuss the clansmen. They're good at scavenging for food while we travel, but we could always use more fighters.
But training them takes time. I'm not sure we have much of that to spare.
Then you'll just have to find a balance that works. We're okay for now, but who knows how long our needs will change.
So she did this last game, if you remember. Last game, she was like, you know, there are a lot of women in this group that, like, yeah, they can scavenge, but I could teach them how to shoot arrows.
Do you think that's what's going on here, though, where she's like...
I think in general, she's just kind of like... I think she's just has that... She's always in mind where she's like, we need fighters. And that's kind of like giving strength to that character because she's the one worried about your military defense. Mm-hmm. It's pretty cool, actually.
Although, I wonder if in this game...
Thanks.
I wonder if in this game they're going to take it to that point where it goes too far.
Maybe.
And maybe... Rook will have that chance where he is supposed to say, you gotta calm down.
Nah, never. Turn to leave, but Oddleaf places her hand on your shoulder.
We should talk, Rook, at some point.
Talk about what?
You. Not you, the leader, but the man I knew from Skogr.
What does that mean?
Talking about the man she knew before he lost his daughter.
No. Before Skogr. That was the town they came from. And then she gets... Is she hitting on him? She might be hitting on him. I don't know.
I guess...
Romance!
I almost would hope not, though. Really like Oddleaf as that, like, fierce, strong, independent woman that don't need no man.
Maybe. Depends on how you talk to her in the first game.
I guess that's true, yeah.
Alright, let's go talk to this guy. The Varl mercenary leader, Bolverk, and a rather large female fighter are talking to Juno, a member of the Spellweaving Members' Council. Bolverk looks annoyed. Nothing unusual. You stick away from Juno.
Default annoyance face.
Do you want me to handle this one? I feel like I'm giving you all the female roles. So
I'm trying to think of a good female voice for, I don't know. There's no haggling on this. You've already accepted the offer in Boersgard. I can't ever say that elegantly.
Boersgard. Get this one to do it. Get this one to do it.
Get this one to do it.
get me to do what? If Juno is surprised by your presence, it doesn't show. She continues to stare straight at the Varl. She's so terrifying.
She is kind of terrifying. Rook is saying, to the survival of this caravan, something I doubt you care to do. Oh, shit. She's over here.
Oh, wow. Okay. He won't be seeing to anything much longer if he keeps fighting like he did earlier. That's a good point. Say nothing, but I'm still here now. Again, what other tasks are you talking about? I think that one.
Yeah.
Just get to the point.
I don't know if saying nothing is ever really good for Rook right now.
It's true. Shows weakness.
The determination will see these people safely to Aberang, but with respect, our discussion stays between us for now.
We look at Bulverk, says she expects him to keep it private.
Even needs my help healing the wounded, but we should leave soon. See Hakan at the dock when you're ready.
Now,
she still is terrifying, even if she seems pleasant.
Isn't it possible that Avond actually dies in the other game? Like in the first one, like during that huge battle on a bridge?
Yes! I think he can!
I don't remember.
No.
It never happened to me because there's no way I would...
He doesn't die. I think that's the last scenario in which Eagle, the shield bearer, can die.
Oh, saves him. Okay, that makes sense.
I think that's if you battle too many times on the bridge or something like that. I don't remember exactly because
I can believe it.
Harry Poppins knew better than I.
Juno leaves without another word. Fane Valka, one of these days, Claw and Fang will get thirsty for the Spellweaver blood. Jesus, you're such a jerk. Claw and Fang? His axes. The large axe heads are polished, the blades sharp, and the cheeks scarred from plenty of use. But the gray handles that stand out, they're unlike anything you've seen before. How long are you going to let Juno tell you what to do? You avoid his goading. Only to Aberang, there's a... Then it's King's Minof's... Oh, King
Minof.
Minof?
Minof.
Minof's job? Like he's got to answer to any of this. He's royally pissed himself whenever he's seen a dredge. The pigtailed fighter laughs. Have we met? You can talk for her now.
I'm just tempted to give her, like, strong German accent.
I'm Volker,
a shield maiden in charge of keeping the ravens alive.
You're terrible.
It is terrible. I'm not going to do that.
Volker gives her a stern look, but she doesn't back down.
I already know who you are, chieftain.
Or there's a problem I should know about. Do you have a better idea than Aberang? Let's respect Juno's words.
Yeah, okay.
Okay. Yeah, make a new plan. You think some walls and a king are going to save you? Fair point. Bulverk... Oh, go ahead.
Oh, you can do it. You're the narrator.
Mm-hmm. Bulverk snorts and turns his attention to a large sealed cart behind him. His bare cloaked back and indicates the conversation is over.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Cold-shouldered.
This guy. I didn't even realize that he was going to come with... All right, so...
Well, I mean, he didn't really have any options, seeing as how the harbor town was in
ruins.
That
is true. There were multiple boats that went to different places, presumably.
That's true. I feel like, though, the destination was like, well, there's only really one place to go at this point.
So, all right. The wooden planks and the well-used dog creak as you walk across them. Do-do-do-do-do. Hakan, a warrior recently acknowledged as King of the Varl, paces on the dock. You want to do Hakan?
Sure.
Not sure I was made for this.
He says as you approach.
Commanding at battle is one thing, but deciding how many chickens we need to bring? What is this?
We've both made harder decisions. I'm just as lost as you are at this. You seem to be handling it just fine.
Just keep doing what you're doing, man.
That one just...
Alright. I'm not looking for praise.
Hakan says.
I just want to know what we're expecting when this is all over. There's so few Varl left. How do I keep my people alive?
You search for something to say, but he stops you.
I'm not looking for an answer from you either. It's something a Varl king should be able to figure out. Let's sail.
Depart.
Yeah, I don't think we had any chance to actually spend our renown other than on the market.
Yeah, it's fine. After lighting the funeral pyre, the last villager finds fine seats on your... I just messed that entire sentence up. After lighting the funeral pyre, the last villagers find seats on your rickety long ship, built of scrapped wood, scavenged, and Beauregard. The ravens find space around a large cart on the black-sailed vessel. Oars slowly move all the boats into the river's current.
Nice.
Fun fact. Port side, starboard, comes from actual, originally Scandinavian, because... right side, which is starboard, translates from steeroboard, which basically means right-handed, because people would steer with their right hand.
Okay.
Because you would dock on your left side, and that's why it was porting on left side.
Right.
Fun fact. Anyway, Halo looks ill.
At least it's not the brackish sea.
He whispers to himself as he steps around rowers and baggage to speak with you.
I'm not sure why we were all built for aquatic voyages,
he says.
And I hear Eberang is quite a distance away. My people could use a few hours of rest and solid ground.
Weakling. The hopeful looks from others sway you, and you signal for the ships to make a land. Would you mind telling me why the capitals are destination? Oh, no, that was you, sorry. Elio asks. Arboring's walls have never been breached. The Valka Juno says the menders there can protect us. It's the furthest place from the dredge. It is just now. Help, bro.
I mean, honestly, I feel like we've already seen that walls mean nothing.
True.
We can't necessarily rely, like, the menders are amazing, but they're not necessarily like the end all be all. Said that backward. I feel like, honestly, the only reasonable answer is that right now it is just the farthest place from the dredge. So if we're going to recoup, that's the place to go.
Yep. You know what? Plus, we don't need to give him too much information about the menders, even if it is the truth.
That's true. He probably doesn't even really understand what the menders are.
Yeah. He'd be like, I thought those were a legend. Whatever. Noob.
Reason enough. After what we just endured.
The Scald says, his eyes looking distant as he recalls the fight.
Stone armor and strange humming weapons.
No joke.
Dredge.
Elio says, almost in awe.
Man. And Varl's storied foe from oh so ever long ago.
Look at that little run there.
But they're real. And here, how have they made it so far south?
His glance at the Varl is met with both anger and shame. Ooh. The longship rocks gently, and the Scald grabs a rope and steadies himself.
If only we had the fabled horses to ride upon, we'd outpace the dredge and be on sound footing.
His dramatized misery is almost as amusing as his thanks when he steps back onto the land. Morale improved.
Yeah.
Oh, look at that.
So that's an interesting tidbit. Apparently, horses are not a common thing in this world. Which explains why we have an ox pulling the wagon in the previous game. But I wonder if that has anything to do with the horseborn.
Well, it could. In general, in our world, we like to think, or we have this like notion that horses were everywhere, but they actually weren't. There were many, many places where horses are just, they're just not natural there, but they were brought over when, they were brought over from a lot of like different European nations, stuff like that, depending on where they're at. So yeah, it's fabled horses actually that. You don't think of it that way, but yeah.
Fair.
This is the map of the world.
Hoorah.
This is your location.
Yeah, cool. I wonder if that means that we're going to be using the map more in this game.
I'm actually wondering that right now, because before it was just, like, pretty
sort of
cool.
A reference point, yeah, more than anything.
Click on Borrow's Guard to find out more information about it. Okay, so nothing really new there, actually. Although... I wish I had used this more often because you get a nice little thing. I'm just going to keep it on the screen for a quick second. You can pause it if you really feel like reading this. And moving on. See what I did there? Yeah.
So then this caravan is attempting to reach Asmodril by River on the way to Hammering. Click on it to learn more about it. I mean, it's kind of cool that they're like, hey, you should probably learn some stuff if you're really into this. Just so it's here, just so you know. Because, like, I feel like in the last game, we all figured out that it was there at one point, but, like, I didn't realize just how much flavor there was in the map until I had already played through the game at least once.
I mean, I spent a little bit of attention to it before, but you get so caught up in what's actually going on that it takes you a couple playthroughs before you're like, I need to know everything.
That's fair.
And pause now if you want to read this. Moving on. Arborang is the capital home of humans, basically, or at least the humans that were... that are constantly being talked about. The world map is covered with so many locations that is stuff is crazy. You can explore the map at all, clicking on the location for more information.
Tell you what, I think this is it for the episode.
Yeah.
What do you want to ask about the question of the day? We could make it about the map.
Actually, in general, I really want to talk about how you feel about the game currently, in how it's telling this story currently. Because I'm finding it's a little strange, right? Because it got so intense at the end of the first game, and now we're at this point where people just feel very unsure of themselves, and the people who are really experienced, Rook and Ivor and Juno and all them, are just like, yeah, just get it done. And everybody else, especially Alio, is just like, what's even going on?
It's very much like very experienced has now met the very inexperienced.
Yeah. So in general, how do you feel about how it's telling the story? Do you think that it dipping down in this arc, which is typical, do you think that this is a good place for it to be story-wise? Or do you think that they should have made it a little more intense to start with? I guess this is my question. Narrative, sure. You know, narrative speak.
Narrative flow.
Yeah. Bam. Cool.
Well, be sure to share your response in the comment section below, where we'll also have another copy of the question there.
Also, vote above.
Yeah, do that thing. And if you like this playthrough so far, you can do two things to support that. And one is click this little annotation above us that says, hey, you want to watch us play more of this. And in the video, give them one of those thumbs up things. Well, thank you everybody for watching. I hope you stay tuned for the rest, and then we'll see you in the next episode.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Goodbye.